Hi everyone, this is Tara. Today we are going to discuss an important wireless communication technique, that is the wireless local area network, standardized by IEEE 802.11 standard and is popularly known as Wi-Fi, that is wireless fidelity. And throughout this video lecture, I will be covering the fundamental concepts behind the technology, the protocol stack of IEEE 802.11 wireless LAN, the frame header format, and we will also discuss various design issues, particularly the MAC supply design issues, like how the media access control protocol is designed. So let's start our discussion. So we are starting with a definition for the wireless local area network, and this is a definition that is given by Cisco. So a wireless local area network implements a flexible data communication system, frequently augmenting rather than replacing a wired local area network within a building or campus. So here you have to highlight the term that is augmenting and replacing. That means you have to view the wireless LAN as a supporter to the existing wired network, but not as a replacer. Now the wireless LAN helps to transmit and receive data over the air using the different bands of electromagnetic spectrum, like infrared or radio waves. Now some of the advantages of the wireless LAN. So the first one, mobility. The wireless LAN provides the support of anytime, anywhere ubiquitous computing. That means you can move anywhere and still be connected to the network. So it provides real-time information, which is necessary for many time-critical situations in which the decision making is based on the real-time data gathered like the stock information, the weather information, etc. The next one, the low implementation cost. So those who are having the Wi-Fi connection at your home may notice that the cost of the Wi-Fi router is slightly more, right? So with even though it is costlier, how can I say that the implementation cost is low? It is because the implementation cost doesn't mean only the monetary cost. Rather, it includes the cost of maintenance, the cost in terms of time required to establish it, and so on. So it is easy to set up, relocate, change and manage a wireless local area network. The initial cost of the hardware may be higher than the wired network, but the overall installation expenses and lifecycle cost are much lower. Then the implementation speed or the installation speed is fast and easy here. As we all know, if you want a Wi-Fi connection at your home, what you have to do? You will be getting the, you have to install the Wi-Fi router, and that you can do within a day or two. And once the router is installed, you are getting the connection. It is that much easy. Next one, that is network expansion. It's a very well-known saying that the wireless can go where the wires cannot. That means there are some places where the wired connection is not feasible, like the communication, like underneath the ground, say for submarine communication or in a tunnel, and many other places. In those places, it is very useful to use a wireless LAN compared to the wired counterpart. The next advantage, more users can be accommodated. As you know, compared to wired network, you can support more users in a wireless LAN by sharing the resources, that is that frequency band. Next one, the reliability. What do you mean by reliability? It is the ability of a system to do a failure-free operation. So most of the failures in wired local area network is due to the cable failure. And that fear is not here. That is, no fear of downtime due to a cable failure. In that sense, they are more reliable than a wired local area network. Now the next benefit is scalability. What do you mean by scalability? That is something that can be increased easily. So wireless LAN can be easily scaled by supporting more number of users. And also there is no fixed topology, so the configuration can be changed easily. Now the most important advantage is like it operates in the license free ISM band. So what is ISM? Industrial, scientific and medical band. So initially this was the band which is available only for these three purposes, that is industrial purpose, scientific and medical purposes, and hence it is known as the ISM band. But in 1985 ISM committee deregulated the use of the band and it is made available to the public, which led to the increase in the development of various wireless standards. Along with that, our Wi-Fi or IEEE 802.11 also evolved. So that is where the Wi-Fi standard come up. Now the next benefit is robustness. The wireless LAN can survive many disasters, like in the case of earthquakes or flood or some other natural calamities, the wired network may completely collapses, but the wireless won't, because they don't have any particular topology or infrastructure. The only thing is you have to save your wireless router. So once you save that router, the network is saved. The last point I mentioned is about planning. So if you are looking at a wired network, before implementing it, you have to do a lot of planning. That is, you have to see the area where you have to deploy it, the number of hosts, the topology, and how and where we have to implement this switch hub. Like, there are a number of things has to be pre-planned. No such pre-planning is needed in case of a wireless local area network. So these are all some of the advantages, but this is a very huge list. You can add any number of advantages like that. Okay. Now, as we said that the wireless local area network just to communicate via the electromagnetic waves, right? So depending on which part of the electromagnetic waves are being used, the wireless LANs can be classified into infrared wireless LAN and wireless LAN based on the radio waves. So first let's see some features about the infrared wireless LAN. So here the transition takes place in infrared bands, that is 900 nanometer wavelength. That you know, this is what we are using in our TV remote control or maybe at a remote controlled toy. In all cases you could see that. And here also in wireless LAN we can use this wave forming something called the infrared data association. Now the senders can be light emitting devices like a light emitting diode, a laser, etc. And receivers they have to be sensitive to light, right? So the receivers are photoreceptors. So it is simple and cheap technology. As you know, what about the cost of this LEDs and all, it can be easily integrated to handheld devices providing an interface for the infrared data association, and it supports data rates up to 4 megabits per second, and it is license free, of course. And the main advantage here is the electrical devices do not interfere with it. And next, when we look at the radio based wireless LAN, there you can see such interference with the this radio waves. The electrical devices may interfere with it. So these are all the positive factors about this infrared wireless LAN. Now there are certain limitations also. The first one is the line of sight requirement, and you know that infrared is a very high frequency component of the wireless of the electromagnetic spectrum, and we transmit on high frequency, so we need directional antenna, and hence line of sight is required. Now the infrared data association devices are connected to a serial port, hence the data rates are limited, and they cannot penetrate through walls or obstacles, and the range is limited compared to the radio based wireless LAN. Now let's see about the radio based wireless LAN. It transmits at the 2.4 gigahertz ISM band, and they do not need any line of sight, and they can cover large distances, and they can penetrate through walls or obstacles, and provides data rate up to 100 megabits per second and more than that in the recent standards. Now some of the limitations, just opposed to the infrared wireless LAN, here this radio based wireless LAN can interfere with the electrical appliances or other radio devices. And very few license free bands are available. So as the license free bands are limited, the utilization of the band is something very important here, and it is harmful for the human beings. So they are not recommended for to use in some sensitive places like the hospitals or where small children are there. Okay, so that about the radio based wireless LAN. Now some popular forms of the wireless LAN. The first one, the most popular form, is the 802.11 standard, that is our Wi-Fi. And other than that, we have Hyper LAN, which is a wireless LAN developed in Europe, and but it is not that much popular. And another one, Home RF, which is used for connecting the home appliances, and forms like a Bluetooth, a mobile ad hoc network also. Now let's see about the 802.11 standard. So how this standard is evolved, that is we are going to see here. First let's see what was the triggering event that led to the development of this standard. So that happened in 1985 when the Federal Communications Commission deregulated the spectrum from 2.4 gigahertz to 2.5 gigahertz for use by industrial, scientific and medical communities. That means till 1985 this band is specifically used for industrial, scientific and medical committees, but on 1985 it is deregulated in such a way that it can be used for other purposes also. Now the spectrum was available for individual non-licensed application, and it was a great opportunity for the wireless application developers, because they can now develop their application without investing much on the licensing. That means they are exempted from the license fee. This led to many developments that were proprietary, expensive, slow and lacked widespread availability or adoption. So naturally when people started developing it, they started developing it in a proprietary basis. So it's an expensive solution, speed is slow, and it lacked the widespread availability or adoption. And it is at this point the IEEE 802.11 standard was developed to provide a reliable, fast, inexpensive and robust wireless communication standard that could operate on the license-free ISM band. So it gained success due to its compatibility with the current IEEE network, particularly the 802.3 Ethernet. You know that how much popular the Ethernet 802.3 standard is. So the main attraction of 802.11 protocol is it is backward compatible with the 802.3 Ethernet. Since its ratification, it has been under continuous innovation and updation, and we are going to see some of such updations, and that is what we call it as the amendments to the basic protocol. So the IEEE 802.11 evolution. Many other standards were released as amendments to the original form, and they were named as IEEE 802.11a, 11b, etc., IEEE 802.11z. That means you have all versions starting from A to Z. So like that, they keep on developing it. But the problem here is the standards differ from each other in many aspects, like bandwidth, the modulation technique used, the physical media, the security, roaming, etc. So it created lot of confusions among the people, that is which is to be used, which is better, like that. So some kind of consolidation is needed. So in that sense, in 2007, IEEE published a standard called 802.11 2007 standard, and which is consolidated set of specification for amendment published till 2007. That is the amendments like A, B, D, E, G, H, L and J get consolidated under this standard. So they were rolled up into one common standard. A similar consolidation happened in the year 2012. That is, the next consolidated standard was released in March 2012. That includes the amendments K, N, P, R, S, U, V, W, Y and Z. And recently in 2016, we have a consolidation called IEEE 802.11. 2016, that is a new release of standards including the amendments. It means after that is that we have amendments like AAAC, like that. AAAC, ADAE and AF. That happened in December 2016. And the most recent in progress are the amendments like AX, AY, AZ. And once it is over, it's naming like BA, BB, BC, BD, BE. And in IEEE 802.11 MD, they are planning to consolidate the amendments so far. Okay, that about the evolution of the 802.11 protocol. Now, let's see the difference between the ad hoc and infrastructure mode of 802.11. So, it operates in two modes. As you can see in the figure, first we have that infrastructure mode where the network is based on some infrastructure, some background will be there. So we have the access point or the base station where all the devices are connected and backbones are connected to some access points are connected to some backbone network. And when you look at the ad hoc mode, there is no such a base station or simply there is no infrastructure. Infrastructure mode, the devices communicate with each other via the access point, which is a wireless router. In ad hoc mode, there is no infrastructure or access point and the device communicate each other on a peer-to-peer basis. Let's see some details about the infrastructure mode. First of all, it is a cellular architecture that you seen in the previous figure, where the devices are divided into different cells and we call this cell as a basic service set. So the system is divided into cells or clusters. Each cell is also called a basic service set. And each basic service set is controlled by a station, base station called the access point, which is a wireless router. The cells consist of stations and access points. Station means a wireless host. That is, the device is connected to the access point. Now, the stations are nothing but IEEE 802.11 compliant network interfaces card. That means, actually through that NIC you are connecting to the network. So here they are calling this wireless network interface card as a station to that particular cell. Now the access point is a wireless router. The topology here is similar to a star topology where all the devices are attached to a central hub and communicate each other through that hub. And this central hub is nothing but our access point. And now the multiple base stations can form a something called an extended service set. It is a collection of basic service set. Together we call as an extended service set. An extended service set is connected to the backbone local area network, or that backbone network is what we call as a distribution system. Now the access point provides connectivity between the wireless network and the wired local area network, that is a backbone. The access point is acting as a relay agent between these two. Now let's see some details about the distribution system. So 802.11 is working in both infrastructure and infrastructure-less mode, right? So we have the mesh or the ad hoc topology for 802.11. Particularly 802.11s is a standard that is developed for particularly for this mesh network. But still, however, nearly all the 802.11 networks use a base station oriented topology. So that is why we are focusing our further attention more on the infrastructure based or the base station oriented topology where the distribution system is coming. That means here, instead of all nodes being created equal, and in case of ad hoc network, all nodes are created equal. That means there is no special role for a node like an access point or a normal station. But here it is not like that. Then the roles are clearly defined. Some nodes are allowed to roam like the laptop you are using, and some are connected to the wired network infrastructure. 802.11 calls these base stations as the access point, which are fixed normally, and they are connected to each other by means of the distribution system. The distribution system could be an Ethernet or a token ring, for example, which runs at a layer 2 of the ISO architecture. So some layer 2, that is a data link layer protocol, will be running as a distribution system. It can be Ethernet or token ring or some other layer 2 protocol. That is, it operates at the same protocol layer as that of the wired link. So it converts a protocol from wireless 802.11 packet to 802.3 Ethernet packet and vice versa. That means if the backbone is an Ethernet or you are using Ethernet as a backbone, then in the wireless LAN you are using 802.11 in the data link layer. So when it comes to the 802.3 backbone, the protocol conversion has to be done, and that is also a responsibility of the distribution system. Now let's see an example for the distribution system. Here you can see there are 3 cells, and each cell is controlled by an access point, like access point 1, access point 2 and access point 3, and the cells are overlapping also. Now all these access points are connected together, forming the distribution system. Now how the routing of packets are happening, or how the communication is happening. Suppose let's take an example. Here node A want to communicate with this node E, and you can observe here that the node A is connected with the cell which is under the control of access point 1, where node E is connected to the cell under the control of access point 3. Now how this routing will be done? First, E has to send the packet to access point 1. Now from access point 1, it will be delivered to access point 3 through the distribution system. Now from access point 3, finally it will be delivered to node E. Okay, so this kind of a routing is also a responsibility of distribution system. So distribution system will be taking care of the protocol conversion, the routing, the forwarding of information simply. Now in addition to these, there are 2 more important functionality of the distribution system that we have to discuss. The first one is the access point selection. That means how the wireless nodes are selecting a particular access point that is apt for it. Okay, and one more functionality is the managing of the node mobility, and that we will see in the next slide. So first let's see how the access point is selected. It is through a process called scanning. Okay, and it involves a 4-step algorithm. In the first step, the node which want to be connected to a particular access point, or which want to select an access point, initially it will send a probe frame. It will simply broadcast that probe frame so that it will be received by all the access points. That means in step number 2, all the access points within the reach of this particular node receive this probe frame, and they reply with a probe response frame. Okay, now in step 3, the node selects one of the access point. That means the node will be getting the probe response frame from multiple access points also. In that way, it is up to the node to select a particular access point. Sometimes it may use criteria like the one which is giving maximum signal strength, or if there is a tie, it can select an access point randomly. And once it select the access point, it sends an association request frame. That means I selected you, now I want to associate with you. Now to that association request frame, in step number 4, the access point replies with an association response frame. We can see the algorithm with the help of this previous example. Suppose let's take the example of node B. Say node B is newly joined into the network, and it want to select a particular access point for it. So initially it don't have any idea about the access points present and all. So what it will do, it will execute step number 1, that it will send a probe frame. Okay, so when B is sending, means it's broadcasting, so it will be received by all the nearby access points. So of course here access point 1 and access point 2 will be receiving the probe frame sent by node B. Now both access point 1 and access point 2 respond to this particular node with a probe response message. So now node B will be getting probe response message from access point 1 and access point 2. Okay, now it is up to the node to decide a particular access point to which it want to associate with it. It can select the one which is giving maximum signal strength, but here it is almost looking like equal distance, right? So suppose it is selecting an access point randomly. So whatever it is, so here we can assume that it is the node B selected the access point 2. Okay, now what is the next step? The B will send an association request frame to access point 2. That means I want to associate with you. And access point 2 will be replying it back with the association response frame, and in that way the association of a node happened. Now a node engages this protocol in two situations. First of all, it joins a network for the first time, right? So it want to associate with a particular access point, as well as when it becomes unhappy with its current access point. That means when a node is getting unhappy with the current access point, means it is not getting enough signal strength, right? It may be a situation it is moving, say, far away from that particular access point. So naturally it want to switch to a different access point. So this might happen, for example, because the signal from its current access point has weakened due to the node moving away from it. Okay. Now, whenever a node requires a new access point, whenever a node acquires a new access point, the new access point notifies the old access point of the change. That means whenever the access point change is happening, it is responsibility of the new access point to inform the old one that such a change happened, so that the further routing and all will happen nicely. And this happens in step number 4, and it is also through the distribution system. So that about the scanning algorithm. Now about the node mobility, that means how the distribution system is taking care of mobility of the nodes. Here also we can see an example just like this here. Suppose in this particular wireless LAN, the node C want to move from the cell controlled by access point 1 to the cell controlled by access point 2. That means it want to move from here to here. So naturally, how this will be handled? It is very straightforward. You just have to rerun the previous selection algorithm. That means now it has to select a new access point, right? That means here at some point C prefers access point 2 over access point 1, and so it associates itself with that access point. So as it moves away to the new cell, it sends a probe frame, and which eventually result in the probe response frame from access point 2, and followed by it will be executing step number 3 and 4, association frame and association response. And by that it can de-associate from access point 1, and it can associate back to access point 2. So that is how it is handling the node mobility. Now let's see the concept of active and passive scanning. So far we saw how that scanning algorithm is running, and the algorithm, the procedure which we seen so far is called active scanning. That means the node which want to associate to some access point is initiating the process. Like the mechanism just described is called active scanning, since a node is actively searching for an access point. Okay, now there is one more possibility is there. That means instead of the node searching for a device, the device itself can advertise that I am here with this much capability and all. So device normally advertise its capabilities by means of something called a beacon frame. So the access points also periodically send something called a beacon frame, and that advertises the capability of the access point, and this include the transition rate that is supported by the access point and some other features about it. Now once a beacon frame is coming, if the node want, it can select that particular access point, and that process is called a passive scanning. And that means this is called a passive scanning, and a node can change it to this access point which is sending it that beacon frame based on the beacon frame it received, simply by sending an association request frame back to the access point. That means you have to omit step number 1 and 2, you can directly go to step number 3 and 4. Whenever it is receiving a beacon frame, it can directly send the association request frame, and the access point will be replying back with the association response frame, and hence the node can associate to that particular access point. And with this, I am winding up the first part of this wireless local area network, and the second part you will see in the next video. Thank you.